Savior was born.
Thank you.
but I'm not holy, not all is strong and all is bright. Born and born and mother and child, holy infant, tender and not silent, not holy, not shepherds wait at the side. Glory stream from heaven and far, heavenly blessing, hallelujah. Christmas time, listen time, 5, 6, 7, 8. Let's get back to Bethlehem. 1, 2, 3, 4. Christmas time, listen time, 5, 6, 7, 8. Let's get back to Bethlehem. Let's get back to Bethlehem. Okay, Ajit. Hope to see you now.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome to Kannamma Bedi Kathora and family.
Yes.
Lexman, first day of your job, right?
How did you do this?
That's a moon job, that's a little bit of a bar.
This is my dream job now. I've been waiting for this for 3 years. Now I've got an opportunity. I believe in myself. I'm going to prove myself by being successful.
That's great, man. But let me tell you one thing. Life is not about achievement and the position you have. There are much better things that can add meaning to your life.
You're too philosophical, my friend. I'll prove you wrong.
It's okay, don't worry. I will help you for your success.
All the best, Mr. Ajay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
If you can't even do this, what is he here for?
Tell me, what did you say?
Nothing, sir. Thank you so much for fighting for my promotion.
You are most welcome. And I can see that you are very happy. And I want this effort to be continued as always.
Congrats!
I told you, right?
Really happy for you. I was in this race before, but I'll tell you stories later. Congrats again.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, congratulate me, please. I have achieved everything I want. I to stop. I'm not going to stop. If you ask me to stop, I'm gonna do everything it takes to come out in life. I'm gonna do everything it takes to come out in life. I'm gonna do everything it takes to come out in life. I'm gonna do everything it takes to come out in life. If winning is the only thing that matters in life, I wish to win every time. I am willing to have all the victories. I do not care what I have to do for it. I will do anything to achieve it. I am willing to do anything to come up in life. I'm gonna do everything it takes to come up in life. I'm gonna do everything it takes to come up in life. I'm gonna do everything it takes to come up in life. I'm gonna do everything it takes to come up in life.
Where is Devina?
She is still sleeping. Do you need a coffee?
No, too much caffeine today.
So how is my director doing?
I don't know. Do you think I'm there already?
Where?
Generally in life?
Yes, of course. You are the best. I'm proud of you.
Whatever. I've climbed to the top. Faster than others, but still, I'm fighting for something that is not there.
You are there. It's me who is struggling with that question. I thought baby was everything for me at that point of time, but I think I shouldn't have sacrificed my career. It's still haunting me.
But it was your choice. Do you think your career would have satisfied you?
I don't know. Maybe not.
Mandar again.
Whatever.
Tell me why I'm wrong.
Hey Varuni, how are you? Yeah, I need to talk something with you. Okay, so can we meet at a place tomorrow? Okay, thanks, bye, see you tomorrow.
So Ajay, what made you remember me? It's been around 7 years. Yengappa irundha vera naalu? Tell me your story.
Varuni, do you remember the challenge I made on the day I joined office?
Yeah, I do, man. How can I forget that?
I must admit, I lost the challenge.
Adavide Ajithe, but I'm glad you realized that. But what made you to realize?
Everything in this world is nothing. And everything in this life is meaningless. You know what? I have a 7-figure income. I have a condo. I have luxury cars. But still there is no fulfillment in my life. There is a void in my life. But I don't know what it is.
That's correct. Absolutely right. Life is actually meaningless. I was like you, chasing after my ambition, until one day I lost my job. I was clueless until I came to know what gives me true fulfillment. You know what? There is something that gave true meaning to my life. Not just mine, but for the entire mankind. I know I might sound crazy, but it's truth. This thing I'm talking about is real, and through this you can find the meaning for life and fulfillment. You won't believe the shape of the emptiness I had is the exact shape as this thing.
Hey, what is that, man?
It is the relationship with Jesus.
Contracted some strange disease, and shortly thereafter it died. And soon after, another sheep gave birth to a small little lamb. But instead of the sheep developing some complication, the small little lamb that was just born, that developed some complications and it died. So here he found himself in that situation. On the one side, he has a mother sheep without a little lamb. On the other side, he has a little lamb without a mother. You know, on the one side, there's a lambless mother. On the other side, there is a motherless lamb. So the solution seemed rather obvious to him. He thought, okay, I would do something. I would get this little lamb, you know, to this mother that has just lost its lamb and make it feed and nurse and give life for this new little lamb that was just born. But, you know, the situation didn't go as he planned. Every time he brought this little lamb to this mother, to the sheep, you know, this mother lamb, sheep, it sensing something, some different smell rather than its own child, you know, it every time kicked it off. So he was like, you know, very concerned, how am I going to give life to this small little lamb? Then he, you know, developed a plan, rather a genius plan. He found the body of the little lamb that just died, and he took the, you know, he took the skin out of that small little lamb and put it on top of this little lamb that was living and brought it to the mother. And this mother, ready to back off and kick that, you know, little one, suddenly sensed something, you know, something of its own, something of its own child. Then it began to, you know, the story goes this way, that it began to nurse this little lamb and began to give life to this little lamb. You know, this is a simple story, but it has a splendid application, especially in the light of what I want to share with you this evening. You know, this shows, this is just exactly like this little lamb, you know, found it like the mother found it like a stranger, you know, and it backed it off and it couldn't give life to this little one. You know, the Bible says we are alienated, we are separated. You know, usually we talk about the original sin in the Garden of Eden. Sometimes we may think, you know, what is the big deal? You know, somebody, you know, God made this man and somebody ate this apple, ate this fruit, and, you know, we call it sin. No, it is not, you know, as simple as that. It is like mankind declaring our own independence from God, declaring our separation with God. We are saying to God that we don't need you, you know, we want to be separate. In that sense, we are alienated. You know, the Bible call it, you know, death. Actually, in the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve, they did not die physically. But something happened. We call it spiritual death. What exactly is that? You know, what exactly we call as a spiritual death? It is a separation. It is the separation of relationship with God. That is exactly what happened in the Garden of Eden when mankind declared separation with God. It's a relationship, you know, it's a separation of our relationship. That's exactly what happened in the Garden of Eden. We found ourselves like aliens, and we were alienated from God. You know, that is the story of what happened in the Garden of Eden. And this small little lamb, that's exactly what happened, that it found itself as a, you know, separated one from its mother. You know, today, this is one of the biggest problems that we face in the world. This, I don't know, you know, in the earlier era of sports, people might know about this famous tennis player called Arthur Ashe. He was the first one to win Wimbledon, no? The very first black man to win Wimbledon. And people call him as a gentleman, both on the court as well as off the court. You know, people call him a great man, not just a great tennis player. You know, he was also a great person, a very gentleman he was. But he contracted AIDS, not through any immoral activity, but because of a blood transfusion, he got AIDS, and, you know, eventually he passed away. He said something that was very absolutely powerful, and, you know, something that we have to think about. a man who was dying of AIDS, he said, as painful as AIDS is, even more painful is the rejection I face because of my race. You know, a dying man will not confess something like that if it's something that's deeply bothering him and, you know, making it most painful for him. He said, as painful as it is living with this AIDS, dying with this AIDS, even more painful is the rejection of my race, the rejection that I face every single day. This is something that, you know, bothers every single one of us. This is something bothers, you know, many people around us today, that something that we cannot take, the rejection, you know, rejection in relationships, rejection in all the situations that we face, rejections, you know, in the family, rejection in the relationship. Now today, when we look at the story of Bethlehem, the story of Jesus, you know, Jesus came and make us acceptable, make us acceptable to God. As I told you, in the Garden of Eden, we felt alienated, we felt separated. But God came into this world so that, you know, you and I can be, you know, we are not rejected, but we are accepted. We are received by God. That is the purpose of Bethlehem. That is the purpose of Christmas. You know, receiving us as God's children. That is the, you know, great purpose that we have in Bethlehem. I don't know how many of you, I think all of you know this Bollywood movie star, Shah Rukh Khan. He was, a few years ago, in Forbes magazine, named him as the most influential Indian. You know, the most influential Indian. And I heard one movie, you know, the salary for one of his movies is 50 crores. And, you know, he had all the wealth he needed. He had everything. But a few years ago, when he was attending a film festival in Goa, when the reporters asked him some questions, this is what he said. You know, he openly said, it's available in the media, it's available in the news. This is exactly what he said. He said, I have everything in life. I have, you know, all the money I need. I have all the fame I need. I have everything. My father did not, you know, leave anything for me, anything behind for me. He did not leave any money for me. But today I am wealthy. You know, I have so much to leave behind for my children. He said, I have everything in this industry. And I have a very good family. You know, I have a good family, good wife, and I have good children. And I also have a lot of good friends. With some of them I spend time and, you know, have good relationship. He said, yet with all this, you know, with all the things I have, yet there is some strange emptiness within me. Some strange emptiness which I don't understand. And I continue to act in order to fill my emptiness. He said the same words, exact these words. He says, I continue to act just exactly the way I act in the movie. I'm also acting in the real life as if everything is okay. But believe me, it is very, very lonely at the top. You know, the top movie star who was earning that much and who has a name and fame and everything, he said, believe me, it is very lonely. There is a strange emptiness. But the Bible says Jesus came into this world and he said, I have come to give them life, and life in all its fullness. I have come to give them life, and life in its all its abundance. The moment I read that interview, the moment I read that, you know, news, I thought, no, there is a way. There is an answer for him. There is a way for him. You know, he doesn't have to act to fill up his emptiness, and that's not going to deliver for him. And Jesus promised that the only true life that can be given is through him and through a relationship with him. That is the only possibility. And today, you know, if you don't know that relationship, I want to encourage you that it is available in Christ. The story of Bethlehem gives you and me that possibility to connect with God, to relate with God, no matter what situation we are in. You know, one of the biggest challenge and the problem that mankind face today is that this big issue called human trafficking. This is something, you know, the sobering, painful, agonizing issue. Something that we couldn't even understand. Just a few weeks ago, I happened to meet a person from India And as I was having a conversation with him, he told me that his wife is working for an organization that rescues children, young children, from the sex trafficking industry. She goes to different places and finds these people in various ways and rescues them. He said, "You won't believe it happens in every place." He asked me, "Where are you from?" And I named the town in the South India that I come from. Can I tell you, my wife is dealing with a case just exactly very near to your town. These things, something that you do not know, but it happens everywhere, all around the world. You know, the statistic says every year 200,000 children in India alone are trafficked for sex or other purposes. And every day 300,000 children are, they are drugged and they are used for making money for somebody, you know, for begging and things like that on the streets. It happens. And I asked him, you know, it's something unimaginable. How is it possible? How is it possible that, you know, somebody would think of doing this kind of harmful things, horrible things to little children? And he said, you know, it all depends on what you think. You know, if you have an idea that I can use you, I can make use of you. If you have an idea that I can make use of somebody so that my ends will be met, so that I can make money, so that, you know, I can live in a better house, I can have more money, I can make myself wealthy. If you have that philosophy of life, if you think that I can use somebody, you know, it is possible. The moment when you think that you can use people to meet your ends, you know, all these horrible things, they begin to happen. And it is the big problem all around the world. But the reason I'm telling you is, it's a mentality that how I can use somebody so that I can get something. But is it not true, sometimes the same thing flows into our own relationships as well? You know, in our relationships, even in our family relationships, between husband and wife, between, you know, other relationships in the family that we have, if we think, you know, if I think of myself, that what I get out of this relationship, what I get out of, you know, this relationship, you know, in some way, that we are also under that impression that, you know, our convenience matters, our comfort matters, our, you know, situation matters, what I get out of this relationship. But, you know, I want to tell you that in every relationship, there is a trace of selfishness. There is a trace of, you know, self-centeredness. But I want to tell you that there's one relationship in which the value is placed not on the person, the value is placed on whom the love is spent. You know, when you come before God, the value is placed on you. That is the reason He came down on planet Earth. When I talk about this strangeness, you know, in John chapter 4, there is a story about Jesus meeting this woman. He's meeting this woman at the well. She was, you know, going through so many things. People usually call her a prostitute. Because when she met with Jesus, Jesus was talking to her and he was telling her, he told her that, "Bring your husband." She said, "I don't have any husband." Then Jesus said, "Yeah, what you said is quite true. You had four husbands and the one you are now living with is not your husband. So you have just told the truth." And people usually call her, you know, immoral. But I don't really think of her in that sense. No, I think of her in that sense. I think of her this way. That, you know, she was going through so much turmoil, so much pain in all the life. Probably all the husbands she had, they were using her up. You know, they were just considering as a commodity to be spent. You know, they were just using her probably. Probably she might have thought, "My next husband will treat me well. Probably the next relationship I will find true love." And one after another she went through all the relationships. Finally, she came to a conclusion that, you know, this is not going to work anymore. And she was living with a man, you know, with whom she was not married. But Jesus met her and he told her that, you know, everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again and again and again. But the water that I give, which he was talking about his life, the life that he gives, they will never be thirsty. Just like Shah Rukh Khan said, just like what you saw in the drama, you know, in the movie, that this person is, you know, pursuing and pursuing so many things. In the end, he's coming up still empty, still wanting to achieve something, still looking for something. You know, the very hunger that we have in our body, I think it's an indication of something greater. It's something, the hunger that, today actually I wanted to talk a little bit about the hunger for relationship, which can only be fulfilled in Christ. Because the very hunger that we have is an indication that, you know, there is something deeper hunger. There is something, you know, there is something spiritual hunger which can be satisfied only in Christ Jesus. And that relationship is available through Christ Jesus. Yeah. You know, last month, on the 5th of November, something happened. I think many of you might have read in the news. In Texas, the place called Sutherland Springs, on a Sunday morning when people were worshipping, one gunman entered into that church building and he locked up the door and he, you know, sprayed the bullets on everyone, whoever in front of him, and killed 26 people. And, you know, I was reading that news. He said, pointed the gun towards the people, said, "Now everyone is going to die. All of you are going to die." And he sprayed as much as he can and killed as many people as possible. One little girl, her name is Rihanna, she survived. And she was 9 years old. She's 9 years old. And she said this, "You know, the reason I am alive is because of only one reason. Because my mother stood in front of the gun and received all the bullets on her and protected me. The only reason I am alive here today is because all the bullets were sprayed on her and I am spared and I am alive." You know, when I talk about sin, when I talk about life, because of sin, the gun is pointed, death is pointed toward every single one of us. And Jesus, on the cross, now I don't have time to go into much details, on the cross, that's exactly what happened. Now whatever that supposed to happen because of our sin, he received all the bullets on him. He received everything on him so that instead of death, you and I will have life. Instead of, you know, the Bible says he tasted the death. In other words, he went through the fullness of death and he went through all the, you know, all the impact of death on himself so that you and I can have life. Just exactly that little girl who was supposed to die but was spared because somebody took all the bullets on her, the same way Jesus took all the bullets on him as death was pointing towards every single one of us. And today, what we go through, the Bible calls it, is not the real death. What we go through is the shadow of death. In other words, we are not going to eternally die. We are going to eternally live if we have Christ in our lives. And what we go through is the shadow of death. And the real impact of death, the real taste of death, is what Jesus went through on the cross. The story of Bethlehem, which started in the manger in Bethlehem, which ended on the cross, is for you and me to have a relationship, our hungers fulfilled, our deepest longings fulfilled. No matter how much we achieve, we will never be fulfilled in life. No matter how much money we earn, we will never be fulfilled. No matter, you know, how much wealth we accumulate, possessions we have, no matter how many things we have, even how many satisfying relationships we have, we will only be fulfilled if we have a true relationship with Christ. If you walk through Orchard Road today, you will see the decorations there. And they say this year's concept of decoration is endless wonder. Endless wonder. And I read the news If you go through the Orchard Road in the afternoon, they are lighting up 3 p.m. in the afternoon itself, because they want more people to come out and do shopping. You know, more people to, you know, go and walk through the road, walk through the shopping malls and do the shopping, and it is called endless wonder. You know, I'm not against any of these, but I want to tell you, on the first week of January, when you walk through this Orchard Road, this endless wonder will come down. You know, you will not see the lighting anymore. No, the shopping madness will be over, and all the fun, lighting, everything will be over. It will, the endless wonder will come to an end. But I want to tell you another endless wonder which you can have. This is true. This is true. No, and there is an ancient story in the Bible. Many of you might not be familiar. So I just want to narrate, and with this story I want to come to a close here. There was a man called Job, and you know, some of you might know the story, some of you might not. And this man, the Bible says, a very devout man, a God-fearing man. And he was a, you know, one who fulfilled every law, one who, you know, had compassion on the poor, one who gave to the poor, and a very, very pious man, religious man, humble man, good man, godly man. But as it happens in the world, many times bad things happen to good people. Is it not true? The same way, not only bad things, the worst imaginable things happened to him. On a single day, he lost everything. He lost his wealth, he lost his health, he lost his family. He had 7 sons and 3 daughters, 10 children. He lost all of his 10 children, and his health was deteriorating. He was sitting in a pile of ashes, and his wife told him, "You curse God and die. Because we have received so much evil on a single day. You received so much evil." And I believe she was so angry with God, because God has taken her 10 children away on a single day. She said, "Why don't you curse God and die?" That's exactly what happened. You know, that's exactly what she said. But the story did not end there. At the end of that book, after you read the 42 chapters, the Bible says God restored everything back to Job. This man, you know, God came and blessed him and restored everything back to him. Every little thing. But the Bible says God gave him double, everything, twice as much he had originally. You know, just I put it up for you so that you will understand. He had 7,000 sheep, 500 donkeys. God gave him 1,000 donkeys. Everything doubled. Sons and 3 daughters. God should have given him how many? Very easy mathematics, right? God should have given him how many? Actually, God should have given him 20 children, right? God should have given him 14 sons and 6 daughters, so that everything, the score is settled. He is doubled in everything. But God only gave him 7 sons and 3 daughters. When I meditate this passage, it was really absolutely amazing and mind-boggling. You know why? Not only because, okay, there are 2 reasons. One, all the other things he mentioned, the sheep and camels and oxen and donkeys, they are going to end. They are going to come to an end. But there is no end for the children. We are talking about the endless wonder, right? The real endless wonder is only going to happen because they are with God. When Job enters past this life, and when he enters eternity, he will still have 20 children there. Because children, people are the one who can relate with God. People are the one who can, you know, go to his presence. The story of Bethlehem, actually, it's not just God coming to meet with us. It is God coming to, you know, coming to meet with us, but not just, you know, not just, it's not just an end in itself, but God wants to take us to be with him, and we can be with him, and we can have a relationship with him. In other words, children cannot be replaced. You know, I heard it, and the score is settled, but the life is not going to end here. It is going to continue. It is going to be endless. It is going to be wonderful. It is going to be a glorious, endless wonder. Only because they can have relationship with God. It is not going to diminish. If God had given him 20 children, you know, there is no value for you and me. In other words, it conveys a great message. You are a unique individual. Nobody can replace you before God. Now the Bible says, if God, you know, its story is told, if, you know, God as a shepherd, if there are out of 100 sheep, if 99 are safe, if one is lost, God would still go after, the shepherd will still go after that one lost sheep so that he can bring that lost sheep back. In the same way, every single one who has come for this Christmas celebration, you are a unique individual in the eyes of God. God would say, if you are, even if there is only one person, you are the only one person in the world, God would say, you are worthy. So much so that I can go to the cross and give my life. I can bear all the bullets, you know. I can receive all the spray of bullets on me so that you will not die, you will live, and I can die and I can give you that life. And that much you are unique individual. You know, when I saw that story, it's absolutely mind-boggling that God did not diminish the value of a person. Whether you know him or not, whether you presently know, have a relation with him or not, he still values your uniqueness. That is why God did not give 20 children to John. Because every single one on planet Earth is unique. Out of 60 billion people who live since the time of creation until today, every person, wealthy or not, healthy or not, you know, whether you are in a good situation or a bad situation, whether you are educated or uneducated, every single one is absolutely unique in the eyes of God. This is the story of Bethlehem. This is the story of God fulfilling, you know, our deepest longings and hunger and giving us a life, life in all its abundance. So with this, you know, I want to invite you, when we say, come back to Bethlehem, Bethlehem means house of bread. It doesn't just mean that physical bread, it doesn't just mean physically what we can have. Jesus declared himself that I am the bread of life. In other words, all the deepest hungers and longings that we have can only be met in Jesus Christ. And it is available to every single one of us. And I am inviting you, come back to Bethlehem, where you can find true life, true purpose, true meaning, where God values you as an individual. Probably, you know, you may go through so much pain in the relationship here. I don't know whether we will have perfect relationship on planet Earth here today. You know, some of you may have, you know, good family, everything is going good. Even then, I want to tell you that you do not know, you know, what Jesus can offer to you. The woman who came at the well, you know, she was talking to Jesus, and Jesus told him, if you knew who is it that asks you, and if you know the gift he can give you, you would have asked him. In other words, even if everything is going good for you, even if, you know, all is okay, even if, you know, you have everything is, you know, absolutely perfect, still, you don't understand what you are missing if you don't have Christ in your life. If you are going through some pain, tragedy, agony in relationships, I want to tell you, the best way to start is to have a relationship with Jesus. And that is the beginning. And he will give you a brand new start. And that will be an amazing, absolute start for every single one of us. Can I invite you to this, back to Bethlehem, this evening? Shall we all rise to our feet and pray? This evening, I believe God has dealt with you, God has spoken to you. I don't know what situation you are in, but in Christ there is a new life, a brand new life. And I want you to pray a simple prayer with me. And in that, it's very simple and very easy to start a relationship with Christ. Just invite him into your life. The one who was born as a baby in the manger in Bethlehem is the God of the universe, who can meet the deepest longings of our lives. We don't have to be lonely. We don't have to be hungry. We don't have to be going through the painful things. We don't have to suffer alone. There is a God who can come and change every little thing in our lives. If you think that God has touched you this evening, if you think that life can be endless wonder and that life is only found in Christ, He has a value for you, so much so that He can die on the cross for every single one of us. You are absolutely unique in His eyes. No, what a loss it is if we don't have a relationship with Him. And this evening, just pray this prayer with me. Simple prayer. Just in your heart, pray after me. Say it after me in your heart. And that can be a beginning of a new, brand new start in your life. Dear God, thank you for making it clear to me. I never knew you, Lord. I never had a relationship with you. But today, I see that in you, not only my needs, but all the deepest longings and hungers that I face can be met. And Lord, today, I surrender my life to you, and I want to establish a relationship with you, so that my life will have a brand new start. And I can live because you died. I can have a start in life because you gave your life. Thank you for receiving me. Thank you for accepting me. Thank you, Lord. Father God, we pray for every single person who is before me today, Lord. We pray that as they came to celebrate Christmas with us, oh Lord, they not only enjoy the company, they not only enjoy the show, but Lord, we pray they will receive something deeper in their hearts, oh Lord. Peace in their hearts, oh Lord. Joy in their hearts, oh Lord. And Lord, all the relationships in their lives, oh Lord, will make perfect sense when they make a commitment with you, oh Lord. When they begin a relationship with you. Let there be the day, oh Lord. Let today be the day that they come to know you, they come to meet with you, they come to relate with you. Bless them abundantly, O Lord. As we have seen, their lives will start to have a new, wonderful, glorious life, that they will have that real, endless wonder, O Lord. We give you all glory and honor. In the matchless, mighty, precious name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. Please be seated.
Thank you, Joseph Anna, for that message. Actually, Joseph Anna said that he is in between you and the dinner, right? It's only one third is me, the other one third is suspect. I'm going to share with you. Basically, we are a group of professionals. We are having our professional chapter meetings at various places across the island, which are on the right hand side. We have some places by the profession itself. It's a networking session on every first Friday. Some of our friends might have attended these sessions. We actually have started in view to add value to our work. Some of the things like health at workplace, stress management, work-life balance. These are some of the topics we had, which could be very much helpful to all of us at our workplaces. So later we're going to give you all the feedback forms. Our friends, volunteers are there. Please fill it up. And if you are keen to be part of any of these Friday, for one of the Friday events on a monthly basis, or any other comments. In any other comments, you can even share the topics that you may be interested in, which would give us some input so that it can help us arrange better sessions for you, which can benefit most of us. So this is the last part. This is the last final one third, which is in your hands. So as fast as you do, we are straight away to the dinner. That makes the full picture. What's the other one third, right? So as the feedback forms are being distributed, please raise your hands if you need any pen, right? And every form, please, is very, very quick. It will not take more than 5 minutes. If you are quick, it will take probably 3 minutes, right? Not more than 5 minutes. Please fill it up and pass it back to our volunteers. And thank you very much once again for your attention.
Shout for joy, see what love.